Hi, my name is David Garcia, and I'm the Characterization Services Manager at nanoComposix. Today, I'm going to be giving a brief overview of the instruments that we use to characterize our nanomaterials. Every product we sell comes with a certificate of analysis. We use the six techniques that I'll be discussing to make all of these measurements. Everything is a core part of our QC process, and is why we pride ourselves on such highly characterized nanomaterials. If you're not buying a nanomaterial from us, but want your nanomaterial characterized, we also offer these techniques as a service. For more information on each technique and submitting a sample for analysis, please visit our Characterization Services page. TEM is a technique that is used to image materials that are smaller than visible light and thus cannot be seen on a conventional optical microscope. In a TEM, one side has an electron beam and the other side has a detector, in this case a CCD camera. In between is your sample, which is dried down onto a grid. Nanoparticles absorb the incoming electrons, which creates shadows where the particles are. From this data, you can learn about the particle's size, structure, shape, and even crystallinity. TEM is a vital characterization technique at nanoComposix that is used to quantify the base or grain particle size, an important metric that is featured on all of our certificate of analyses. If you also know the concentration of your particles, you can combine the numbers to calculate things such as surface area and particle concentration. To understand how our particles absorb and scatter light, we use a UV-vis spectrophotometer. Not only do you learn optical properties, but the spectra from UV-vis measurements can also be used to evaluate particle size, shape, concentration, and whether or not your particles are aggregated. To measure UV-vis, a beam of light is shown on a sample that is in line with the detector. The sample will interact uniquely with certain portions of the broad spectrum light sources, leaving behind an extinction spectrum that is characteristic of that material. UV-vis is a critical characteristic of all our products, especially the extremely bright noble metal plasmonic particles. Due to the relative ease of measurement and the multitude of information it gives, it's also used here as a routine QC check. For more information on UV-vis, please see parts 1 and 2 of our UV-vis tutorial video available on our websites. Many of our products are used for in vivo applications, and so it's really important for us to make sure that they are free of bacterial contamination. We determine this by endotoxin assay. An endotoxin is a component of the cell wall of gram-negative bacteria that can cause many health problems once it's in the bloodstream, such as septic shock. A special reagent isolated from horseshoe crab blood is added to a sample. If there's endotoxin present, a series of clotting reactions will occur that causes the sample to become turbid. The rate that it becomes turbid is proportional to the endotoxin content, and this rate can be compared against a standard curve to calculate the endotoxin concentration. ICP-MS is the most sensitive method we have to identify and measure the concentration of metals. In an ICP-MS, super hot plasma is used to atomize samples, creating ions. A quadrupole mass analyzer filters these ions based upon their mass to charge ratio, and ions that pass through the filter hit a detector and are counted. This can be compared against a serial dilution curve, and extremely precise concentrations can be determined this way. ICP-MS measurements are essential in determining the concentration of our products. This in turn aids in the calculation of particle concentration and surface area. DLS uses light scattering to determine the average hydrodynamic diameter of a sample. The hydrodynamic diameter is the size of the base particle plus the layer of ions, molecules, and covalently bound ligands on the surface that travel with the particle as it moves in solution. A beam of light is shown on a dispersion of nanoparticles, which scatter light to a detector that is offset at a high angle. The Brownian motion of the particles creates a pattern of light at the detector that fluctuates at a rate that is a function of their size. The DLS is similar to the UV-vis in that it requires a similar sample prep and is a cuvette-style instrument. It's a quick way to verify changes in surface chemistry and to monitor the stability of colloids. Zeta potential is another important characteristic of many colloidal systems, and it is also measured on the same instrument that we use to perform DLS. In summary, the zeta potential is the electrostatic repulsion or attraction between particles. Highly negative or highly positive zeta potentials indicate particles that are greatly dispersed and stable because they are repelled from each other. Zeta is measured by applying an electric field to the electrodes of a cell containing a dispersed sample. Particles migrate towards the electrode of opposite charge at a rate that is proportional to their zeta potential. The rate of movement is calculated by the fluctuations in scattered light as the particles pass through a 632 nanometer light source. In addition to stability, monitoring the change in zeta potential over time can give insight into how the surface is changing over time. And that concludes our segment on standard characterization methods. Please be sure to leave any questions or comments below and check out our Characterization Services website for more detailed information on each technique or for submitting a sample for analysis. Thanks for watching.